Swagatam. Welcome to this first inaugural event of the Nalanda. Professor Chandra, Sri Dakshi, colleagues and students. We are extremely fortunate to have with us Sri Sudhakar Bakshi today to kickstart this new initiative of Ahmedabad University. We decided to name this the Nalanda, looking at the tradition and the historical form of learning that is deep-rooted in Indian culture. Nalanda, the etymological meaning of it, goes as Na Alanda. There is no limit to giving. And in a university, there is no limit to the distribution of knowledge and learning. Anything that is there in the universe is something to explore, to investigate. The speculative philosophy of the Upanishads was developed in the same fashion as the Socratic dialogues, where you learn by asking questions. And there are no conclusive answers. The best example is the Kena Upanishad, which opens by asking a question. Kena Shita Patita Upreshita Manaha. Who drives the mind to engage in diverse ways? This was the genesis of the Nalanda at Ahmedabad University, where students, through asking questions, can explore knowledge beyond their subject of study. The Nalanda is a multidisciplinary, multi-program, student-driven, aspirational platform of Ahmedabad University, where interested students, and let me tell you, Mr. Bakshi, that this group of students here have volunteered to be here. And I'm told that there are many more waiting to get in, but we are restricting the entry. We are making it aspirational. So the students get to interact with invited speakers. We would trigger the interaction, and thus they have the opportunity to learn as part of a rich heritage of inquiry and exchange of ideas. The university believes that engaging with diverse learning environments, disciplinary stimuli, and points of view makes an individual more perspective and inquiry. One never knows which idea will touch new and open the window to new mental landscapes. India today needs more than ever social, cultural, economic, political, and technological dialogues that will explore relationships between citizens and our institutions to better understand the direction of our growth and our roles within and outside the country. The Nalanda is a program that brings speakers with very perceptive and deep perspectives to engage with the Ahmedabad University community. It is a platform for students to understand, debate, inquire, and reflect the nuances of issues by engaging with such leaders to build their own independent thinking and have the confidence to articulate the same before their peers. This primarily is an event for the Ahmedabad community, its invited friends, where the priority to engage is with the students. I'll take a couple of more minutes to introduce you briefly, Sri Sudhakar Bakshi. He has a long and checkered, illustrious career. And I'm sure I'm not going to be able to do justice to that in the next couple of minutes, but I'll try to do my best. A leading IT industry innovator, Sudhakar Bakshi co-founded Mindtree in 1999 with a vision vision to engineer meaningful technology solutions that help businesses and societies flourish. Under his leadership, Mindtree has grown from a technology startup to a global 500 plus million enterprise with more than 13,000 Mindtree minds in 25 offices around the globe. Prior to being the non-executive director, Mr. Bhakti served as the executive chairman of Mindtree from 2012 to 16. He has also held various leadership roles, including CEO, for the first 8 years of Mindtree's journey. Currently, he has also been appointed as the chairman of the Skills Development Council of Odisha, and he plans to train about 8 lakh people under that program. Mr. Bhakti's leadership development, marketing, and knowledge management initiatives have differentiated the company from competitors since Mindtree's inception. Mindtree is a leading IT company which delivers digital transformation and technology services from ideation to execution, enabling global 2,000 brands to outperform the competition. It helps companies solve their greatest technology challenges by combining the expertise of a large firm, the agility of a smaller company, and a high-touch collaborative culture. This innovative approach has led to several industry awards, such as the Best Managed IT Software Technology Company in Asia and the Best Managed Company in India, 2013, by Euromoney. Mindtree has also been named Most Promising Company of 2013 by CNBC and recognized as one of the top 4 companies globally in talent development for 2013 in ATV's Best Award. Through his career, Mr. Bhakti has been highly acclaimed for his visionary leadership. A 35-year veteran of the computer industry, Sri Bhakti was chief executive of Wipro's Global Research and Development and set up Wipro's US operations, converting R&D from being a cost center to a profit center. Following Wipro, he moved to Lucent Technologies, where he started their Bell Developer Center in Bangalore, India. Sri Bhakti grew up amidst what he calls the material simplicity of rural and small-town Orissa, imbibing from his family a sense of contentment, constant wonder, connectedness to a larger world, and learning from unusual sources. He studied political science at Utkal University, India. From humble beginnings, he went on to achieve such extraordinary professional success. He is on the board of Indian Oil Corporations and also a part of the governing council of IIIT, Bhubaneswar, and the Software Technology Parks of India. He is an active supporter of social causes like mental health, blindness, geriatric care, and engineering innovation through his work with the White Swan Foundation, Aravind Eye Hospital, Nightingale Trust Bhakti Center for Active Aging, and the School of Engineering, University of Florida. He is India's best-selling author of business books with titles like The Elephant Catchers, Zen Garden, The High Performance Entrepreneur, Go Kiss the World, The Professional, and The Professional Companion to his credit. He has also written a business book for young adults, MBA at 16. His books have been translated into Hindi, Marathi, Malayalam, Tamil, Kannada, Korean, and Chinese. But the best part of his life story is that he is a stellar example of having achieved all this together with a very, very strong set of values, belying the common perception that business success only comes at the cost of compromising values. Thank you, sir, for being with us today. And may I request my colleague Saptam to give him a token of our gratitude and appreciation.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Professor Chandra.
Thank you. Let me take these two mics.
I think we are giving you all mics.
Just to remark on what Professor Trivedi mentioned about limited number of students here. First and foremost, there's a video which is going to come and hopefully everybody will get an opportunity to be part of this conversation. But one of the promises that Ahmedabad University is making for its students is we want them to become independent minded. And the whole idea of independent mindedness would be to see how we could build a perspective of reflection and confidence amongst absolutely wonderful young students to think on their own. And we felt that I think keeping a close engagement between a speaker and the student might help provide that facility. In a large auditorium with 120 students, everybody who is sitting either at the back or the side, I think hesitates or don't get a chance to stand up, look into the eye of the speaker and ask this question in three sentences. That's really where we want to go. And this event is actually your event. It's actually set up for you to dialogue with Bhakti Sahib. You can think of me as an invisible intermediary. I'm just provoking here and there, and we'll hopefully log questions back to you or thoughts back to you. And I think the faculty don't get a chance. Okay? This is not the chance for faculty to speak unless you say, I'm done. I've exhausted everything that I have to do with. And it's also an opportunity for you to forge a special bond with a very unusual person. And I'll tell you why he's unusual. He once showed me a picture of his home where he was born in Bhubaneswar, not in Bhubaneswar. You'll tell it. And it was a dilapidated building at this gate. What he said was, you know, I went there and brought a brick from there and I kept it to be part of my life. And as we were driving in, I was telling Bhakti Sahib about Ahmedabad University and what's going to come where and what's going to happen, what was there before. And he remarked that, you know, when you break down some things, reuse them, there's a lot of value in, you use a very different term, but a lot of positive energy in the material that breaks. That's Subrata Bhakti for you. So I want you to tell all of us about this phenomenal journey from that home. I'm sure you don't remember that part, but coming up here, what are some few very salient features of your life which helped you make you?
The nature of conversations like this is you kind of draw attention on yourself, rather your thoughts and your awe and your sense of wonder. And I'll tell you that more than going back to tell from what humble beginnings became. And I used to give this humble beginning talk to my two illiterate daughters for a long time. They said, every dad will realize the same story of how when you were young, you used to walk bare feet up a mountain both ways to school. So that day I realized the future grow. But you know, leaving that aside. So when you have this humble beginning conversation, it kind of overpowers the rest of it. It won't be to be that happy to show that picture to you guys afterwards because I found it a really wonderful thing. I can tell you that the energy is growing. But my life has been a life of constant wonder. fight. And I think the childhood is precious, but more precious is love. And it is amazing how quickly it will be. So to remain youthful, you have no control of your youth, is a gift of life to yourself. So each it is designed to pass, but when it's not designed to pass, it is youthful attitude to approach. And that gives you a certain adventure, curiosity, willing to push the boundary, and all of that happened as I grew up from small places, I think small places are magic. Small places are your mind. Mind is a very interesting thing. Your mind is a small place. So I grew up, I was blessed to be in small places. And I'm very blessed that after the 42 years away from this paper, I'm now just back on the main one. I was lucky enough to be invited to set up and head what is called the Sustainable Development Project. And as Mohammed said, it is mandated to scale 8 lakh young people, mostly in the age of 15 and 30, and most people are high school dropouts, people who have dropped out of 5th, 8th, and 10th class. So we will need to actually provide them what the life skills to the course of the next 3 years. And in that course, actually, the first thing that I did was to tell the government that I would like to visit all the 20 districts of the state. And on the day that I tour, I hit the road. I covered 7,700 kilometers. It was the first 30 days covering 30 districts, which is roughly a little more than the length and breadth of India. That means each one of the shoreline of India roughly. And half of 2 years to the border. And in that course, I visited this tiny subdivision of district where I was born in a two government quarters. And those were days that people were not born in hospitals. In any case, there was no hospital there. So my mother died, and
kept you making those transitions, including this last one, And tell us also a little bit about this Gardner.
Okay. So quickly, you know, I once read someone who said that man has two futures.
You need to get in the back, in? No? Why don't you then come up? Come in front.
So, you know, somebody once said that man has two futures, the future of fate and future of desire. And sometimes the two will meet, and sometimes, probably most of the times, the two will not meet. So, if you look at my future of desire, when I was your age, was to basically be a researcher and basically to teach. So I wasn't, you know, wanting to be where I am today. That's what makes me fond of institutions like these, and fond of teachers and students. If I can escape ever, maybe this could be a place like this. So though I wanted to be a teacher, that didn't happen, researcher and teacher, that didn't happen. Instead, I landed up in the private sector. I was constantly the black sheep of the family because in my family, you could be a teacher, you could be in the defense services, and you could be a bureaucrat. Okay. Nothing else was actually permissible. And then somebody joins the private sector. It's like, you know, crossing over to the dark side. So I joined, actually, it's not that I came in the private sector with a textile mill. At that time, it was called the Mary Cloth Mills. And, it was a formal work of which to the textile side, so the management training was posted there. After 5 years, I joined the IT industry. It was very nascent at that time. So there were no rules, no boundaries. Trespassers were hired, so that was required, was more attitude than anything else. And learnability is very key, and learnability requires a certain degree of awe and a certain degree of fascination with things that you don't know. And though I studied political science, came from a textile industry background, crossed over to the IT industry, first thing that you realize is you're out of debt. So my job was to basically do errands for the R&D guys. And the R&D guys always looked down on the business guys. Okay. So they would like to hang out with the business guys. I realized that I can't go back and be an engineer. And the best thing that I could do was to learn from these guys, press their legs and get them tea and then in the evening. They would oblige you and they would teach you stuff. So that's how I learned about whatever I learned in the information technology business. And then that is how long this happened. I felt that I was always in the right place at the right time, but actually in life there's no right place in life. You create the right part is what you have, there's only place in life. And to be able to add that right, I think two things are very critical. One is the power to receive. I'm a fresh bread beggar all my life. And if the world comes to an end, and all of us are reduced to begging, I think I'll be a highly competitive beggar. I can beg. So the power to receive is very important, unlike the power of giving. A lot of people can give, but a few people know how to receive. So I had that, and I realized that's a competitive advantage. And I kept it, and nursed it, and I reverted it. So as a result, world gave me money. Bosses gave, subordinates gave, peers gave, and other people gave. So I became rich in the process. And that enabled you to, open doors, which open doors, which open doors. And that's how I was picked up to start Wipro's operations in 1990. When the country was defaulting on an IMF loan and there wasn't money to open a branch office of the country outside. So from those, and then going to the West, where, forget about it, you said IT industry. IT industry didn't exist, but also India didn't exist. I think India came into existence because of, you know, two things for the first time in the Western Western mind, in the popular Western mind. One is the, you know, breakthrough coming to the industry, which more than just foreign exchange and everything else in employment, it gave the brand that Indians are smart people. Earlier to that, people would say, oh, Indians are wise people, good people, kind people, no important Indians are smart people. And the second thing that made India suddenly respected was, unfortunately, the nuclear explosion. And I know how people were looking at us prior to these two phenomena, how people started looking after these two phenomena. We got taken far more seriously. So from there, in between, you know, somewhere of 28 years of age, I co-founded a company that lasted for 3 years, and then it closed down. Very coincidentally, last March, I went back to see that building where I started the company in Calcutta. And even at that time, the building was dilapidated, except because you were young, you didn't realize it was dilapidated. And today, when I went there, I find the municipality has put up a sign saying it's a danger of building. And I have a picture of that as well, coincidentally, so I'm very happy to show you guys that picture. There are two pictures to show. Now, that is a very defining thing, because it started something and it closed down. And then I came back to the IT industry after it closed down. So leaving behind something you can no longer push is not an easy thing. That happened, and then I came to the US state and all that after I came back. And somewhere that in Germany all began. My dream started 17-18 years back with co-founders. And the mindset happened. During the process, see, we were a very founder-driven company. 10 co-founders came from disparate backgrounds. What was common to us was number one, we came from middle-class families. Number two, we had a shared vision. We had a shared vision to do three things. One, we said we'll build an aspirational company. The world doesn't require any variety. So we will build something aspirational. Second, we will build a company which will have shared wealth, not wealth for one individual. The third thing we said is that we will build a company which will not be an island. It will be a company that will be connected to a larger social existence, because businesses cannot succeed if societies fail. So with these three ideas, we came together. And the company, through ups and downs, saw more success than, you know, headway. We took the company public in 2007. It was a great success. And then 2007, around that time, we realized that by 2020, the company must change hands to non-founders. And one of the thoughts that we had to start the company is that our children should not be allowed to work in the company. And number two, our spouses or anybody in blood relatives should not have any company. So given that reality, at some stage, the company would have to change hands. And for that, you know, building a leadership pipeline became a very important consideration. So somehow I felt that building a leadership pipeline, how do you do that? How do you build leaders? Can leaders be built? Can you send leaders to a training program? You know, can you send them to an advanced management program? Can you do, you know, all the ODHR stuff and then you creative leaders. That's not how leaders live theater. And I felt right here wrong that leaders are built not through massification, but leaders are built one person at a time. So that required a very one-on-one engagement with a set of people. And it is extremely time-consuming. And good students and good teachers will realize that. It is time-consuming, it happens over a long period of time, and it happens a lot through a structured process. You know, structure will not be able to create the white space, the fungibility, the, you know, amoeba like situation where, you know, things will bloom, will happen. So what that really meant was that if it is to be a full-time team, somebody had to give up a structured position. Life requires a good combination of structure and non-structure, form and non-form. So in organizations you have hierarchy, and we are more comfortable dealing with hierarchy, but there is something for mentor which does not lend itself to, you know, strong lines and dotted lines and organograms and stuff like that. So the hierarchy cannot be used for creating white space and one-on-one time. So somebody had to pull himself or herself out. And I opted out. Now, with the avowed idea that I would spend time with the top 100 people in the company, assuming about 16 hours with one individual in their time and space. So the moment that was signed off, and the idea was, so what do you call this? And because we're a mind tree, it wasn't difficult to say that person should take on. Then, in fact, somebody said Chief Gardner, and one of the board members, he was British, so he had that British sense of humor and said, Chief Gardner is no work. You go to a public garden and say, who's the chief gardener? You don't find that garden. But he didn't find garden. So he has to be a garden. So he became a garden. Then he realized the significance of it. Sometimes you realize the significance of things only when you start it. It's not front loaded. So the significance of a garden in the context of organization building started by realizing that a gardener is not like a farmer. A farmer deals with massification. So if you go to a wheat field, a corn field, every plant looks the same. But if you go to a garden, no two plants are alike. And the gardener has a one-to-one relationship with the plants. So the pruning that the rose will require is very different from the arrangement that the woman will ever do, but very different from the fruit tree. And the gardener has a very personal knowledge of each plant's nutritional needs, pruning needs, which is not a happy experience for the plant at that point in time. The gardener knows that this is good for the plant and does it with not clinical thinking, but with empathy, love, affection. The second and more profound thing was that the plants don't come to the garden. The gardener has to go to where the plants are. Which was very significant because we had said this top 100 people will not be in one place. Okay. So I would have to go, and sometimes you want to spend time with the mid-level executive in, let's say, in June. And that garden has the job to do. So the only time that the person is available on weekends. So you have to travel all the way to Germany and meet that person in that person's comfort zone, or that person's time and space. So that is how the whole philosophy of gardening came up. My deal with the board of the company was that you will not ever ask me what I was doing with my plants. That information will not be available. Because this is a relationship of trust. And leadership, organizational leadership, being separate. You cannot be a first red spouse and a third red manager at work. Okay? Or you cannot be a first red manager at work and a third red spouse. You know, life is not two separate compartments. It can be, but then you are not your best in that kind of situation. So in that kind of case, people who confide in, I would know what are their vulnerabilities. And then it is not fair on my part to go share them with the organization. But the deal was that I will get all the information that I need from the organization. So if I needed to read somebody's appraisal going back 5 years, that would be a I would need somebody's roles, responsibilities, how that individual is doing, the 360 degree report, the professional assessments, that would be available to me, but nothing from me would be available to the organization. So as a result of that, I basically said that I will also not sit for talent reviews. Because normally what happens to do a talent review, you say, so should she become the head this year or should he become the head? I said, I'm not sitting in judgment there because I know why he should be and you should be, and that's not fair because I'm giving you special knowledge. It was a fascinating experience because, you know, I learned a lot about not just leadership but about high performance. You know, what, and that is a very scalable piece of wisdom because it's not just about high performance as in organizational leadership, but high performance in life. You know, what happens? What, you know, how fragile these people are at some stage? How success can become a very selfish idea? What kind of toll does it take on people? Starting from this, I also began to realize the essence of purpose, what purpose can do, which is the theme of this conversation. I know this is a long answer to a short question. So that was the essence of what environment meant.
You know, I mean, you just touched on the kernel of a very, very important an idea, and that is the wholesomeness of one's life, behavior, purpose. And that it's very difficult to compartmentalize many of them and still be able to achieve that purposefulness in life, which probably comes much, that realization comes much, much later to most people. I'm going to lob this question back into our student group here. And maybe some thoughts that you might have. When you see yourself and you see your own aspirations, do you see this compartmentalization? Here's learning, here's career, here's home, here's something that I want to become, here's something I might become that I do not know because life at times is much of an accident. And also, there's another very interesting underlying issue that I'm observing, and that's, you know, you were at the, and you're still at the top of your game, but you were leading an organization. There's a power and adrenaline and everything that runs with revenues and with achievements, and you, in some ways, are stepping in. And I'm going to come back to that. You're stepping aside and saying, hey, listen, for this organization, the future is very crucial. Somebody needs to do this part. And I'm going to be that one. It's a very interesting, deep choice. And how does that happen? Because this is where I think the purpose becomes important. And everyone's purpose is crucial. So at this juncture, I'm going to stop here, lock this thing back to you and say, how do you react? And are there first thoughts coming in your mind? Are there any questions that run in your mind to this very interesting set of activities, events, thoughts that Bhakti has?
So, you know, his question is, can you really compartmentalize? Do you compartmentalize? how to particularize the zero word? We want to speak about
Sukriti, ma'am, what do you want to say?
Personal life and their role in organizational leadership is not different. It sort of opened my eyes. Like, I didn't see it that way ever. Like, when I look at my father, he's my father, I've never seen him as a professor or as a teacher. And when I see myself up until this moment, I never would have thought that maybe my professional life is could be a sum up of how good I am a daughter, of how good a student I am, and how patient I am with my students. How did this thought come to you? Where did you first come across such a thing happening? I mean, for me this is eye-opening. How did you come up with it?
Let me take a couple of other comments also.
I don't think I have profound wisdom that one day through research I found out that it is a bonus quality. I think it is more philosophy than anything else. Borders are very artificial, they're very nature. So you said this is India and this is Pakistan. Who said that this is the border? Who made that border? It's a landmass, what I would say. The ocean doesn't have a border. Air and clouds do not have borders. Rivers flow effortlessly from one country to another country. So the idea of a border is alien to state of nature. The sky, actually, is not a sky, it's a limitless universe. It doesn't exist in the way that we think it exists. So, the moment we say that, you will hear this a lot when you get into work, don't mix up professional life with personal life. This is the biggest BS you've ever heard. The moment a manager, a boss, a senior colleague says that, shoot the guy between the two eyes. It is the biggest lie. People who do that at the cost of alienation. If you can be loving at work, you'll be massively successful. If you can be loving at home, you'll be massively successful at the business. Who doesn't want to work for a loving boss? Who doesn't like to learn from a loving teacher? So love and emotions, the personal life is all about emotions. Until recently, the workplace basically denied emotions to itself. And so, typically what would happen is you walk in and you get upset, you walk into a boss's office, you get upset, and the first thing that the person says, okay, so I will ask, what are the emotions that is in the workplace? People don't understand the power of emotion. Most significant things in life that includes work are acts of emotion. The word emotion comes from, Latin origin, where the meaning is, emotion is a feeling that moves. It's not a static thing. So that's why you have the word emotion in emotion. So, if that be the case, emotion, love, all these things are very important in your personal life. And in professional life, you're supposed to be clinical, and you're supposed to be indifferent, and you're supposed to be selfish. And did your father or mother ever say, child be selfish? Before you wait, they said, give to a younger sibling first. Right? Share the bed, share the room, share the book. So if personal life is all about the good stuff, how can a professional life be all about clinical, self-centered, full of borders and kind of stuff? So there's no border. You do need a border. Because if you had a car that was an aircraft and you had a fight with your boyfriend, right? You want to leave that fight outside of the room of the aircraft. You don't want to bring it inside. Okay? That is different. So some borders are required because you need structure, but structure is designed
to bring out the best in you, and not to be a limit. How did it happen? I think it happened sometimes silently, gently, because I didn't go to school for the first 8 years of my life. But there were no schools nearby. And I was raised in the tribal districts of Odisha. So I was left to my devices. My older brother could walk to school, so he was sent off. And I was both uneducated and unemployed. So my father would go off to work, my mother would do her stuff, and I would roam around. And I didn't see limits anywhere. I actually happened to go and find the house, which is not in the upper condition, and it was full of trees. I found to my amazement that my most favorite trees are still there. And they're looking glorious and they're flourishing. So I think the borderlessness, this whole idea that it is all one stuff, happened partly through that and partly by the people that you had interaction with. And he talked about one of my defining things has been learning from unusual sources. And Peter Drucker was a big proponent of learning from unusual sources. So he was trying to learn from unusual sources. Benchmarking theory and says, oh, okay, so you are carrying us, so find out what the other philosophies are doing. So if you go to the usual sources, everybody else will go because they're usual sources. So best learning happens when you look at usual sources. So your professional world is full of usual sources. Then it becomes a limit. So more you celebrate the idea, more you are in awe with the idea that I will learn from unusual sources, so that porosity will kick in. So I think it happened early, and the things that you discover which can't be explained are not always data driven in the first glance. So hold on to that, the really nice things.
Anyone else? Yeah.
After you taking up the role as the gardener, was it an instinctual decision or was it more of a logical thing for you? Because these can be very different.
It's a lovely question. Trust your instinct and impulse. Okay. On the face of it was an instinctive decision. But more I think of it was, when you say instinctive, we think it is irrational. Okay. Your instinct can be very rational. If you talk to, a neuroscientist, the neuroscientist will tell you that your synaptic end is not in the brain, your synaptic end is in the gut. Okay, it's gut. Right? So the idea of a gut feel is one of the least understood. And we think that, anything that is gut, I'm not saying every time you have a gut feel, go act on it. But I'm saying, take it seriously. Step back. Say, is that a message? Is that, is it your gut or is it a portion of your brain telling that this probably is something I should do a concept? Now, the face of it, it's instinctive, but it is not disjointed to a thinking mind. And your mind will discover it has many, many layers. Okay, you read about it all the time. One, you will discover the magic of those layers. And it might be a whole thing. And just as I talked about the failure of the professional personal dichotomy, there's also a failure in the body mind distinction. Your gut is body, your gut is not your brain. But I'm saying that today in neuroscience success, gut is a very, very important part. It's a sensory, it's part of the sensory device. So, it is difficult to say that it is purely an instinctive thing.
Yeah. You can stand up and talk, I'm sure you can.
Sir, you've been a leader of that.
You can call the Shukra for whatever sake.
Sir, so I want to ask you that.
Sugar.
For you. Go ahead.
So you open up.
wither and die if I am not with you. Okay. Sid, what's your name?
Yashvi.
Yashvi. Aapka name is Ashim. Sutra. So, Shri, you know, brings us back to the idea of leadership. And I'm a fascinated student of leadership. Not just organizational leadership, personal leadership, political leadership, and so on. So, I've read a reasonable amount on this subject. You know, for definitions, we all love to look for definitions. Definitions reduce things to comprehensibility. And definitions, by definition, tend to be complex. So, one definition of leadership is not complex, far from it is simple, is from American futurologist called Joel Barker. Very few people know him. So, Joel Barker wrote that a leader is a person others opt to follow, to go someplace they will not go by themselves. So a leader is someone others opt to follow, to go someplace they will not go by themselves. That takes away the solo thing. Of course you can do so. But, and you know, there's no scientific definition. Each one will have to find her or his own definition. But this definition is, I relate it to this definition. I feel that the idea of leadership is inherent to a responsibility of movement. You know, you take some people from here to there. Those people actually are wiser and they knew all along that they needed to go from here to there. But they don't go by themselves. So the entire India knew that freedom is good for us. But they won't go. They won't cross the chasm for centuries. And then one man comes and others opt to follow that man. And then move from this end to that end. So if you look at Nelson Mandela, you know, it's the same story. The entire, you know, entire General Electric or entire Unilever knew that they needed to transform themselves, but they won't go by themselves. And then comes a Jack Welch, then comes a Paul Wall who's in the chair. And he says, look, we need to go there, and then we can all follow. So if you see the movie Ten Commandments, you know, where the toiling masses, they were driven to such indignity, physical, mental indignity, they knew that they needed to rebel, they needed to break away from it. And then comes Moses, and they opt to follow Moses across the Sinai desert. So, to me, it's not so. You leave me to myself, to my devices, and not with people, I'll wither the middle of my heart. Thank you. So then I got into this job and went to IKEA after IKEA. and some just the lesson we have three phases of electricity. And then I said, tell me 10 students who are your role models, of which 6 should have gone out of state to work, 4 should be women, and 2 should be standing on their legs, which should have become entrepreneurs, not standing in the job queue. 90% of the lesson they come and say, they will be blocked. And then, slowly they come out. It's not like they don't exist. The system doesn't know. So I don't want IIT. And after a while, the principal, he paused and said, this one girl who studied, she came from a tribal family of 7 brothers and sisters. Father died, and this girl realized she has to take charge. In order to do that, she has to first take charge of her own life. So she came to the ITI and she studied here for 2 years, and now she is in the railways and she is a locomotive driver. So I said, can I talk to her? So all the help will lose the track. It was not so easy. So finally some teacher said, I have a phone number. She was here a few months back. So phone number. Punch, and then she comes to the light. Her name is Uniti. I'm talking to Uniti. So Uniti, I have no clue who I am. And she doesn't have to. Some stranger principal says, speak to this guy. So I said, please tell me what you do. So Uniti told me, and these are her words. She says that my Shatabdi Express को भुवनेश्वर स्टेशन से पलासा स्टेशन तक खींच के ले जाती और वापस ले जाती। I let go, want to touch her feet. So Guni Dinga says, मैं पलासा एक्सप्रेस को खींच के भुवनेश्वर से पलासा स्टेशन लेके जाती और वापस ले जाती। I go to another idea. And they tell me after, you know, making the friends, they say, yeah, we had one guy whose parents were daily wage worker in a place called Udala in Mayurbhanj, Udubali knows where it is, near the forest. And they left the child in an ashram school. He may not know what's an ashram school. These are basically in the interiors of forests. But they make ashrams school so that the childers who cannot afford to raise their children leave them there. So you get food, clothing, shelter, and hopefully some education. So that kid comes from there, goes to Nigeria, and today he is the chief in charge for insulin production in Biocom. And what does he do? Because the land was mortgaged for financing part of the education, mortgage being knocks to a nationalized bank, the money lender. So the guy, first thing he does, knocks back and repays the mortgage and gets the land back. And then he moves around Hansa. I have another idea, and so the principal says that this is a girl who's married at 18. What a cool thing to do. Got rid of the problem. Sometimes the necessary thing to do, because that's a safer thing in many parts of the country. So she gets married at 18, she gets a widow at 19. And what happens when you become a widow at 19? You do not belong to your world. You do not belong to your in-laws, of course, do not belong to your parents and sisters as well. So in that moment of non-identity, she needs an identity. How does a woman get done with identity? So she comes to the ITI in Karamukha and she learns garment design. And today, she's in her 20s. She employs 8 people full time in a garment store in Karamukha. And when she has the time, and you must take a leaf out of her book, when she has the time, she comes back to her alma mater. So I look, Ajay Nizami, so I look at UDP, look at Ami, and I look at Rupanam Namaskaras. And they are so inspired. In the bluest of your blue day, you look at somebody like this, and it's immediately uplifting. So nothing is more uplifting than seeing ordinary people doing extraordinary things. I get my inspiration from all of this.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah, nothing in there. Go ahead.
Sir, it is said that a hallmark of a true leader is to become progressively unimportant. Having worked all your life, do you personally believe in this philosophy, or a person who is as such a perfectionist, would this pose as a contradiction to him? So I would like to know that.
Well, I think leadership is very critical to be entwined with the idea of what Peter Drucker, in a great respect for this man. Peter Drucker is considered the father of modern management, but his management can be a clinical thing. So he's really a philosopher. He's an immigrant who moved into the United States at home and extensively wrote 50s, 60s, 70s. What he wrote in the 50s is still relevant today. So Peter Drucker, at the end of his life, towards the transition of the century, used the term planned abandonment. Planned abandonment. Okay. Abandonment. A planned abandonment. And said that leaders must understand the importance of planned abandonment. What he meant by that is he said that we cling on. We think there would never be a time that would be dispensable. Right? Now life, Mother Nature, is all about planned abandonment. The time comes when the cow kicks the calf. Time comes when the bird pushes the chick out of the nest. So you have everything. And Peter Drucker said that we should do planned abandonment when things are 80%.
80%?
Complete.
Complete.
Always be there. So we always say, oh, my job is not yet done. It does not mean you are not a perfectionist. But there is a sense of infinity when it comes to institutional building. There's a sense of infinity when it comes to research. There's a sense of infinity when we are immortal. So we need to understand and appreciate where your plans are. The second interesting thing is that if you don't do that, then you will always be the tallest guy in the party. Job of a leader is to get smarter people. Job of a leader is to be surrounded with highly competent people. And today's multidisciplinary world, it is not possible that you do everything. You can do everything. So I find a lot of leaders struggle. And there are countless organizational examples. They struggle because they are the tallest in the team, which means that everybody in your team will interview for a job. Then the team is not growing. And then who is the stumbling block? You are the stumbling block. So there's some sense of joyfulness to be surrounded with greatness. And for that, I will have to actually step down, I have to step aside. You don't have to always step down, sometimes you have to step aside. And you have to rejoice in the fact that the other person is more brilliant than you are. Of course, it requires a certain sense of self-awareness and a certain amount of emotional security. But always remember old man trouble, plan abandonment.
So let me just tell and come back to those two questions that I just let me tell you on the board of my dream, Bhakti Sahib stepped aside to make way for a new chairman, and it was all triggered because there was a thought that a new CEO with new energy had to come in. And in order to bring that CEO, that space had to be created for others. And I think that's what he's talking about. And yes, that is
IT industry, so it's a youthful industry. And you can't have grandpa, pa, and child in the same company. So he said there were 44-year-old, who was 28 when he co-founded the company, as a co-founder. So he was 44. You thought 44 is better than 60. So let's bring the 44-year-old CEO, which meant that the current CEO had to moved out, which meant that me as the executive chairman of the world. It's a very joyful thing to see now.
Let me talk a little bit about this purpose. Are these by any chance contradictory, or are these very attuned and aligned with each other?
These mean purpose.
Purpose and leadership. Can leadership be without purpose? And what is, where does this purpose instinctively come into play?
Well, let me put it this way. The idea of leadership without purpose sounds very dangerous to me. It can be very dangerous. But purpose is a very interesting thing as to what it gives you. I think the Dalai Lama once, and this is not game dropping. It's a very interesting defining moment. I met him editorially in the sense that I used to write a column in Forbes India called Zen Art. But I would meet another interesting entrepreneur and share ideas of the journey and share stories of the journey and try to see if there's something interesting in that person's story that I can go and share with the readers. Once in a while, we'll carefully depart from the fall and talk to an entrepreneur of a different kind. So we said, let's talk to Dalai Lama as the representative of the Buddha and ask him what Buddha think about current
business. That's nice.
So he said, we'll call him CEO of the soul. And he playfully agreed. So I was chatting with him. And this was one day after his 74 So I asked him, look, you fled Tibet when you were 16. And you have not yet delivered on your promise. It's very unlikely it would happen that in your lifetime Tibet would be free. So here we are. We fail to deliver on a promise on a quarterly basis and we go into deep depression. And you have not delivered all your life. And then every morning you open the door and there are a bank of TV cameras, and there are thousands of your followers, and there are state heads who are there to meet you, and your first job, first thing in the morning, is to smile. So where do you get the power to smile? So to that the Dalai Lama said that your purpose determines your power. What purpose you have, the power is inside, not inside. But if you set the purpose and suddenly, magically, it grants you power. The Devi Mahatma was thrown on the railway platform. And he felt that upper thigh is fundamentally wrong. And he said, I'm embracing the purpose of fighting upper thigh. This person up to that point was an ordinary guy, irrespective of the fact that he was a barrister from London. Suddenly, from that moment, the purpose started pulling him, and the purpose gave him power. So, I couldn't actually give you all the name of this. But I'll give you another interesting realization in my lifetime of work. And that realization is, So who's this purpose for? The purpose is an external thing. You can have a purpose for yourself. You can have a purpose for your child. You can have a purpose which extends beyond your child, to your child's friends and neighbor. You can have your purpose to actually extend beyond your neighborhood to the underbelly of the neighborhood, which is Islam. Now, the moment you actually address a purpose where the beneficiary is far removed from you, greater becomes the size and the power of your country. Look at Kuwait, the millions of children who would be able to, even if they had money, who would be able to afford bed. They're not friends and family to begin. So if you look at, someday you must look at a film called The Infinite Vision on YouTube about an unusual doctor called Dr. V, who set up the world's largest eye hospital called Irving Eye Hospital, which has got 40 million, I'm sorry, 32 million, must be close to 40 million now. Has seen close to 40 million patients, done more than 4 million surgeries, 70% free of cost, okay? Or very little cost, because the other 20% what they pay is for less. Now, Dr. V, Mr. Kurian, Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, the impact that they made over time was determined by the purpose, and that purpose gave unusual power because the beneficiaries were far removed from the actor. So that is why we talk about purpose-driven leadership. The moment the leader takes on a purpose, the purpose determines your power. Then, even if you are not delivering for 60 years, you can still look at the camera and still look like a handsome guy.
There's a question there. Yeah. Go ahead, yeah.
So as you said, you always like to work your team, but I don't think it's easy to work with a team. There are people who have different thoughts. So as you said, you have worked for shared vision and mind dream. So I would like to know whether there were some problems
certain people who might not agree exactly what your vision is. So how did you handle those people? So you know, when you work with a team, getting consensus is sometimes about. But a good team, and good team takes time to build. A good team knows where to stop. And you need to recognize the power of debate and the power of dialogue. Debate is different from dialogue. So you have debate, you have dialogue, and then you have consensus, and then sometimes a decision has to be taken, which may not have anything to do with any of this. But you do go through the process, but a good leader will know when to abandon which process. Because you work with external compulsions, because they're custom, there's a deadline. You don't have all the time to do all the debate and have all the consensus taken all the time. But you also need to understand that somewhere you can draw the line when there's an urgency. And I tell you something that I heard from Mr. Narayana. They were also a large founder-driven organization. So the founders actually settled that everybody must voice opinion. Everybody must say, what do I want for the larger good? But finally, they said that Finally, after everybody has spoken, one person will speak, and after that, there will be no leader. That is critical, where the team says who the captain. Now, that captaincy comes with not the capability of ego, but the qualification of respectful listening. As a captain, my job is to listen, and listen respectfully, and take the best, but not claiming the value, because in other gens, decisions must be taken. Now, why should a group of people grant you that? A group of people grant you that because they ought to follow. And they know at the end of the day, you are saying not because you know the best, but because you have distilled the best, and sometimes added a flavor. The second is when they know that you are a leader with integrity. And that's where integrity, we talk about values earlier. Integrity is very critical. So if you have integrity, you are already respected the team. The team will say, okay, enough. Now the decision has to be taken. Somebody has to say, so who is going to back first? There's no conversation on that with the priest. The other very important thing in that kind of a setup is a shared vision. Egos will kick in. Fred at first will be there. But finally, people will see value in forging ahead only when they have signed up for a larger thing. Then you say, okay, man, enough. Why are we here? What is the larger goal? In today's time frame, I'm absolutely clear what Pankaj is doing is wrong. And I'm absolutely clear the path Pankaj is suggesting to us will take us 8 days, the path I've figured out will take us 1 day. And we may not survive for 8 days because the competition is knocking the door. So I know it's good for the team and good for every one of us if we win in 1 day. But the team doesn't think so. Will I submerge my wisdom and ego at that point in time? I will, you know, with a little bit of, you know, little bit of haircut. But I'll do that if I believe truly that we are here for a common cause and a larger goal. It also comes with maturity. You know, building any institution requires necessarily, like building a whole line, it requires a long view of time. So when you have a long view of time, you have maturity. The leader is somebody that you have opted to follow. And there is a sense that, you know, no one individual is going to do something which has got vested interest. I may completely disagree with Pankaj, but I know Pankaj may be wrong, but Pankaj doesn't have a vested interest in the outcome. And what are sometimes it is not easy. Sometimes it's hurtful. But you know what? Sleep is a beautiful thing.
Yeah. You know, you're the only boy asking this question that I can't ignore you.
So now I'm familiar with your speech on purpose and your platform. I watched that speech and you described four quadrants based on the degree of purpose and platform. And you also said that countries also can be placed in that particular quadrants. So how do you see India since the time of independence till now transitioning from which two quadrants? From which quadrant we have transitioned, and where are we now, and where the future takes us?
So what's your judgment? What do you think India is?
Up till now, whatever I have read, we are our progress is being hindered by our biggest platform, that is our government. because of the degree of each intellectual, because of the organizational fancy in our world. That is my point of view of whatever I have read about.
Okay, so for those of you who are not familiar, I think one of the largest,
I think the largest piece of work that I, theoretical work that I did in my life, thanks to this dark evening side of the people, was this idea of platform and purpose. So I realized that your life can be explained in terms of a 2x2 matrix. So on the left hand side, on the y-axis, is your platform. And the x-axis is your purpose. The y-axis is your platform, which consists probably of six things. Number one, it's your education. Where did you study? Ahmedabad University. People can figure out what that means. Okay. So your education, then your experience. What did you do? I did this. So education, experience, your network. Who do you know? Then your network. How much money do you have on material securities you may have? Then is your family. Then not meaning necessarily in that order, I'm saying family. And last but not least, your health, your personal health. So your education, your experience, your network, your family, and health. These six factors broadly constitute what platform you're standing on. When platform is a springboard, you are not supposed to stand on the platform, you're supposed to jump off that platform. It's like a railway platform. The platform is not a place to sleep on. You go someplace on the platform. So where do you go? That going is determined by your purpose, which is your x-axis. So platform on this side, purpose on this side. Now what is purpose? Purpose is one of the so-called thinking is I to the power of T, which is impact you make over time. So if you mentally create that model, which by now you are not getting it right, so you get four quadrants. You'll get this leftmost quadrant is low platform and low purpose. And then you look at the quadrant adjacent to it on, you know, on the y-axis, sorry, x-axis, is high purpose, low platform. On top of that, are high platform, low purpose, and then is what you call the magic quadrant of high platform and high purpose. So there are people who will lead a low platform and low purpose life. You left behind your 7th grade, 6th grade best friend in this small town who's just, I'd got admitted to not Ahmedabad University, but the local U college, and then done something or the other, and decided to take up a small job in that small town that I left behind. And he or she will continue in that track where it's a small platform, and it's a low platform, and a low purpose. By low platform, don't think it is low lead platform. It is low platform because low is equal to I to the power of T. How much impact you make? You make impact, good impact on your own friends and family. But it will impact thousands of people. Then comes a quadrant where high purpose and low platform. So some friend of yours who did not go to the university, went to ordinary university, and decided to be as math teacher in the local school, a science teacher in the local school. That person could have gone to IIT, gone to Ahmedabad, gone to Kennedy School, but said, no, I want to stay put and I want to teach math and science in a Jawaharlal Vidya. So high purpose, low platform. And then some guys will go to high platform and low purpose. You go to Harvard University, PWD, you go to Stanford, go well, and order to a rich kid to come from very wealthy parents. But it is all about me, myself, and I. So you have the one PM company, you buy the Mercedes. You have one house, you buy the second house. So the impact you're making over time is limited, but the resources that you have command is very high. So that's high platform, low purpose. There will be some people who will combine high platform with high purpose. So those are people who make the highest impact over long period of time. So another one we use T as an institution in itself is their high platform and high purpose. So I began to then realize that this model can be even used to explain where a society stands at the point in time. And a country stands at the point in time. So a political party stands at the point in time. We don't discuss which political party, but Hunter was a very sensitive place. Now, to that is this question, where is India today? Is India high platform, high purpose? Is India high platform, low purpose?
We could take a poll to get a sense.
Well, what do you think India is? How many of you think that India is low platform, low purpose? Raise your hands. Low platform, low purpose. No, I'm very patriotic people. How many of you think India is low platform, high purpose? Low platform, high purpose. Okay. That's interesting. How many of you think India is high platform, low purpose? Less number of people. How many of you think, so no point asking the last question. I do not think India is low platform, high purpose. I think India is high platform, low purpose. India is not low platform because look at our land mass. Look at the number of sun days that we have. Look at the natural resources we have. Look at our demographic dividend. Look at our civilization, look at our history, look at the multiplicity, multi-fabric culture that we have. So India, and you look at countries like Finland, you look at countries like Sweden, you look at countries like Singapore, where those people do not have any of the stuff we have, or we had. So we are high platform by any stretch of imagination. But why, you know, why would I make a controversial statement to say we are low purpose? Low purpose to whom? I think we are low purpose to ourselves, and also from a global scheme of things, we are an unfulfilled promise. You know, if India, you know, if India does not, beyond political rhetoric, does not make a contribution to sub-Saharan Africa, who will? If India does not show the path because of its culture of empathy, its culture of engagement, its culture of multiplicity, to a world riddled with divisiveness, who will? But are we really making up to that challenge? Or are we too internally focused? Are we too concerned about what's happening in Delhi? You know, are we civilizationally aware of both our strength and our weakness? And not just our problems, but our potential. I think the last 100 years, you know, we have also missed the bus, but I think we have gotten off and gotten on the bus train, whatever you say. But just as we are coming in, you know, I was lamenting to Apurva and to Pankaj that what business do we have as a country to be the number one arms importer in the world for the last 10 years? Number one arms importer. You go to any vet state in India today, an average cop actually is given an assault rifle, assault red weapon. Makes zero sense. Why? Because of the national defense. You think anybody will ever come to India and take over this border game, etc.? It's a nice game to play. But, you know, who would betray the Chinese if they ever came and took over India? Right? It will be the most expensive proposition. Nobody is going to take us in. We need to build that emotional security to make to say, you know, we will be able to play much bigger game. Now, I'm not being cynical. I think your generation can deliver the failure promise. Your generation can disengage with history that has no meaning in the larger scheme of things. So I believe that India has the capacity to be high development and high purpose. And India must go there. But it's, you know, history is waiting for that to happen. Today, India is high class from your groups.
Soon after my entry was founded, the global economy faced a dot-com bubble burst. So in such time of hardships, how difficult it becomes to lead your team and to keep it motivated to perform?
See, the funny thing is, when hardship, all these are, you know, I think it's download from internet, right? And there's a little bit of marketing in it, right? So this is history in hindsight. And it pays to romanticize it, you know, the times of hardship, etc. But when that hardship happens, it didn't really feel like hardship. You know, we had the sense of humor, and we had the sense of joy, and we had trust in the future that something nice will happen, something good will happen, you know. And if it doesn't happen, then so be it, you know. Nothing will go wrong. There was a time when all of us were hanging out of a bus. There was standing space, footboard space, but not sitting space. Did it feel like a hardship at that time? We come back and mourn at the end of the day? No, man, it was brave, it was cool, you know, all the girls gave you admiring looks, okay? So it was okay. I remember, now that we're talking about this, I was in the evidence secret, and my first census came out of the state was in Maharashtra, so we come all the way from Bhubaneswar to Maharashtra to enter camp, which means that it's a 48-hour train journey. So 24 hours, almost 24 hours in Hyderabad, and you have no place in Hyderabad. So you need to wait and everything else. So we slept on a platform and wait under that, not the cap, that big thing that fills up steam. And then figured fine, we went there for soil moving, came back and just in time to catch the bomb train. On the way back, there was no reservation, and it was chock-a-block. So I remember that in those days the trains did not have the iron bars over there, so you could jut out of the window. And my body was inside, my legs were inside, my body was outside, and we came from all the way from Mumbai to Hyderabad, and you know, overnight I was posted there. It was the nicest breeze in your face, and it was a wooden plate knife. You know, a wooden beautiful landscape. That memory is so etched in my mind that I would trade that any day for a first-class seat on Lufthansa or whatever they are. So that moment, it doesn't feel hardship. Looking back, it's like, oh my God, you know, so it was hardship. That's been how it is.
Last two questions, and then we'll kind of, you can ask a question outside at lunch too, quickly.
Oh, there's lunch?
There's lunch, quick lunch. See, this is what we do for our students.
Food is so important.
Sir, what advice would you like to give someone going into leadership position for the first time?
First time? So tell me more about that. What do you mean by that?
Someone entered into leadership position for the first time.
Does anybody enter into leadership position for the first time? Were you ever appointed in class? Okay. So you already have entered. And do you have a sibling? Okay, his younger sibling? Okay. So you already been a leader. Right? And did you ever tell your mom or dad, no, I don't think so? On any occasion? Did you say, no, I don't think so, maybe we should be doing like this? Yes?
Yeah.
Sometimes, you know? So you've been a leader. So, life is a community. Life has, it's like getting into swimming in the sea. It's seldom like this. You ease yourself. Please allow to ease yourself into leading. Don't, you know, the moment you say, I'm a first time leader, it will look like you're an amateur. No, you're not an amateur. I'm led. In situations, right? I might not have led organizationally, but I'm led groups. I was captain of my team. I was, you know, my sibling. I was babysitting when my mom used to go to work. When my aunt fell ill and parents were traveling, okay, I used to carry food every day. I was in the situation of leading. So you lead resources, you lead situations, you lead in times of difficulty, you lead with your thoughts, you lead with your responsibility of dissent. I'm not saying right to this end, responsibility of this end. And sometimes you need numbers, you need people. But look inside, lo and behold, you'll find that, you know, validity, which also means that there's no branded leader. Leadership is a mindset. Leadership is an internal aspiration. Leadership is not an entitlement, and leadership is not always vis-a-vis people.
So, Kruti, we started with you, and maybe we should close with you. Go ahead.
Dreaming and dreaming of plans often becomes a necessity. And a while ago, you even mentioned it when you were talking. How do you deal with it? It is definitely not a happy moment or a happy situation. How do you deal with it? Do you drop a bomb? Or is it also a general process and you just let the person decide for himself?
So it is like this. All of you have taken a coalition, right? You have taken a tetanus injection in a coalition, right? And you always loved the doctor who took this in the arm and said, Pankaj, this is going to hurt a little bit. And then somebody was like, it's good for you. So, the way to prune is to say, it's going to hurt a little bit. And important the other individual knows that you're doing it for purpose and need and a larger group. And you're not doing it for your own ego and you're not aggressive. That's a good point to make. Don't be a selfish individual who's figuring out that this is good for you. I decided this is good for you. So I told Jack this is middle of the track. Or it's good for you. So, and sometimes you're dealing with an animal, you know, beings. Sometimes you're dealing with animal beings, but not with your voice anymore. But sometimes you're dealing with situations and people who cannot immediately speak to you. And you have to do something which is not gentle anymore. But you speak. You don't let the little thing touch people, first of all. Don't jab people, slightly.
What if you have asked is a question?
The chances are I'll say no. Or I'll say it hurt a little bit, but now it's not. Thank you very much.
Going to give others just a chance if there are one or two key thoughts that anyone else who's not who's at the corner wants to say. I also want to recognize Professor Apurvanand. Many of you may have read pieces of the most sensitive thinkers and writers of our times in the country. He's a professor of Hindi at Delhi University, and he's visiting us and talking to us about issues related to reading and writing, how do we enhance learning in the classroom. But anyone else who has a question, comment, quick one? Okay, you must ask, please.
Hello, sir. I was curious to know, as a leader, do you have any sight that world has not seen yet?
Do you have what?
Any sight that world has not seen yet.
Sight?
Sight.
Any sight of him
that world has not seen yet?
Do I have a sight as a leader that the world has not seen?
Yes.
Do you think I will ever tell you the answer to the question? And do you think I have a knowledge of that? You know, your sight comes up sometimes as a surprise to you when an unusual situation overtakes you. So, and the mind is an infinite thing, and the mind is deciding what the body will do. And the world outside is infinite in its capacity to create a situation. And the mind is as big as the world outside, in its ability to respond to that. So the sides are not known to you. They may be deeply embedded and magically present, but who are we in the largest of things? And in that moment, I might. That's why we need to feel blessed. That in that situation, I will have an unusual response to an unusual, what do you call it, an impulse coming from outside, stimulus. And that's why you also say, the best is yet to come. My best is yet to come, your best is yet to come. And only trust destiny, we will trust the goodness of life, that when that happens, there is something that will come from the rise to the spot. And may that side be beneficial to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think what a wonderful way to end. And I'm quite sure we could have carried on for another couple of hours. Congratulations to Professor Sridhar. This is a wonderful conversation and a beginning. And I'm sure, I hope you will come back again to Ahmedabad University. I was telling him that whenever you feel that you're crowded on every sense, we'll find your office here at Ahmedabad University. Please come and spend some time with us. and talk to all of us. But thank you for this very positive energy and positive conversation and raising such wonderful questions. And thank you. I think your questions, your thoughts make me very proud. Thank you.